I'm going to speak at the beginning in the generalization of you, me, and us. Okay? So, y'all ever have wood chips in your shoes?
Yeah.
They are the most nagging thing because you don't know that it got in your shoe until either you stumble a little bit, you're like, and you keep walking, and it either causes friction, causes a corn, or it causes some sort of damage, right? Maybe. So then you had to stop and have to pick wood chip out of your shoe, right? All right. So tell me now, what is that small nagging thought that eventually weighs you down, like this wood chip? Mm-hmm. If you don't like the word wood chip, try the pebble in your shoe. Try a stone. So let's be honest with ourselves. These wood chips didn't just occur yesterday. They didn't occur today. And they didn't even occur last week. Many have gone hidden for years, ignored and unnoticed, while others slap you in the face every morning that you wake up, and they crowd you in your bed when you go to sleep at night. Those unresolved thoughts, those images, and your experiences. James Baldwin, said, I imagine one of the reasons people cling to their hates, idiosyncrasies so stubbornly is because they sense once hate or their idiosyncrasy is gone, they will be forced to deal with the pain. So they're going to keep that buffer in place because 9 times out of 10, you don't want to face you. Many talk about the mask that we wear and how we need to take ours off. Have you ever heard that? If people would just expose themselves to who they truly are, then I could get to know who they are? They say, show me behind the mask. Show me what I'm dealing with. My comment to that is, you gotta be kidding. For real? And you lost your mind. Stand myself sometimes. So I know y'all can't deal with me. So the Lord says, caveat emptor. In other words, without a warranty, buyer take your risk. We forget that we must be running efficiently on this journey. On this journey that we walk, that we talk, that we crawl, that we pull ourselves, whatever you do to stay on the journey, you have to be free of guilt. You have to be free of embarrassment, free of fear, rejection, anger. You have to be free of impatience and frustration, just to name a few. These are the intangible wood chips that are damaging because they manipulate us. They cause us to do things such as drugs, alcohol, and other types of addictions because those manipulations cause the pain. I want the pain to stop. So I need to do something that's going to cause the pain to stop or dull enough for me not to even be conscious of it. And so we stay in an unconscious state of mind too often. The only way, prevention and removal are the only options for simplicity, balance, and abundance. I like Mahatma Gandhi, okay? He was a peaceful man. Took him a moment to get there, but you can knock him aside his head and he'll say, can I still give you a hug? That was Mahatma's spirit. He said, the weak can never forgive. Forgiveness is an attribute of the strong. Let me say that one more time. The weak can never forgive. Forgiveness is the attribute of the strong. The weak would say, the wood chip, I have carried around a lot of anger towards someone in my life. I have been hurt by a person I trusted, and for a long time, I wanted to hurt them back. I live in painful stories and in visions of what could have been if I had not been wrong. I blame someone else for the life I didn't have. I feel vindicated in the soul-sucking resentment I carry around from day to day. Does any of that sound familiar to you? But these stories are not just mine to tell. We all have a story. And too often, people don't take the time to understand someone else's story in order to understand why they move in the way that they move. Just a little digression. I remember when I was younger, my father would always, on his birthday, would buy a birthday cake. And back then, we didn't have DVDs. We had the little film on the wheel, you put it on the projector. Like, so anyway, I don't know what I am. But anyway, he would have the kids up in the attic showing these old movies, Woody Woodpecker, Casper, and all that kind of stuff. And then he would have the parents downstairs. So I would always wonder, why do you celebrate your birthday with the kids? Why don't you do what all the grown-ups do and kind of just push us to the side and y'all will be the thing? I understood later, maybe 4 years ago, when my father finally told me the story about when he was younger and his mom had left and had another family. And it was just him, his three brother and sister, his brother and his two sisters, and his dad. Well, his dad thought, she got to live her life, why don't I get to live mine? So he put them in an orphanage. So my father was in an orphanage for about a year before his grandmother came and found him and took them all home. My father's biggest fear was a child. A child should always be a child when you're a child. Allow them to be young. Don't make them grow up too quick before it's time. And I never understood that until he explained why he always would cater to the kids. So again, everyone has a story about some action that you may not understand. Take a moment to ask. Take a moment just to talk. Take a moment just to get to know. These stories, they involve someone who loved who we loved or not, and have since forgiven. That is the ultimate goal. A forgiveness in the fault or the damage. So perhaps the kind of thing I can do for them and for me is not to retell the story, but instead create a new one, a story about letting go. It's time to change. It's time to change. Change is defined as to make the form, nature, content, future course, or etc. of something different from what it is or from what it could have been if left alone. So look at the person next to you and say this. Change ain't fun, y'all.
Change ain't fun, y'all.
But oh my.
Oh,
it is necessary.
It is necessary.
So we're going to speak from Jeremiah 18. I like the book of Jeremiah because I identify with Jeremiah in chapter 1 to the end. For all those that don't know Jeremiah, Jeremiah started his story off with chapter 1 where God told him to get up and go to the people and tell them what he said. Don't embellish anything. Say it exactly like I said. And Jeremiah's response was, okay. So God comes back and says, didn't I tell you to get your tail up and go on up there and do what I told you to do? Does that sound familiar, parents? So in Jeremiah chapter 18, this is talking about going to the potter's house. So I'm going to read this passage in Jeremiah 18, and then we're going to walk through it. I'm going to read from the Message Bible because it says it how I want it said. God told Jeremiah, up on your feet. Go to the potter's house. When you get there, I'll tell you what I have to say. So I went to the potter's house, and sure enough, the potter was there, working away at his wheel. Whenever the potter was working on turned out badly, and sometimes happens when you are working with clay, the potter would simply start over and use the same clay to make another pot. Then God's message came to me. Can't I do just as the potter does, people of Israel? God's decree. Watch this potter. In the same way that the potter works his clay, I work on you, people of Israel. At any moment, I may decide to pull up a people or a country by the roots and get rid of them. But if they repent of their wicked ways, their wicked lives, I will think twice, people or country. I will think twice and start over with them. At another time, I might decide to plant a people or country. But if they don't cooperate and won't listen to me, I will think again and give up on the plans I had for them. So tell the people of Judah and the citizens of Jerusalem my message. Danger. I'm shaping doom against you, laying plans against you. Turn back from your doomed way of life. Straighten out your lines. But they'll just say, why should I? What's the point? We'll live just the way we've always lived, doomed or not doomed. So God's message said, ask around, survey the godless nations. Has anyone heard the likes of this? Virgin Israel has become a slut. Virgin Israel has become a slut. Does snow disappear from the Lebanon peaks? Does alpine streams run dry? But my people have left me to worship the big lie. They've gotten off track, the old well-worn trail, and now bushwhacked through underbrush and the tangled roots and vines. Their land is going to end up a mess. A fool's memorial to be spit on. Travelers passing through will shake their heads in disbelief. I'll scatter my people before their enemies like autumn leaves in a high wind. On their day of doom, they'll stare at my back as I walk away, catching not so much as a glimpse of my face. So, some of the people say, come on, let's cook up a plot against Jeremiah. We'll still have the priests to teach us the law, wise counselors to give us advice, and prophets to tell us what God has come, what has to say. Come on, let's discredit him so we don't have to put up with him any longer. And so Jeremiah says to God, God, listen to me. Just listen to what my enemies are saying. Should I get paid evil for good? That's what they're doing. They've made plans to kill me. Remember all the times I stood up for them before you, speaking up for them, trying to soften your anger? But enough. Let their children starve. Let them be massacred in battle. Let their wives be childless and widowed. Their friends die. And their proud young men be killed. Let cries of panic sound from their homes. And as you surprise them with your war parties, they're all set to lynch me. The noose is practically around my neck. But you know all of this, God. You know they're determined to kill me. Don't whitewash their crimes. Don't overlook a single sin. Round a bunch of them up before you strike while the iron of your anger is hot. So, long story short. Jeremiah goes to the potter's house. He's looking at the potter. Now let's stop where God tells him, go to the potter's house and wait for me to tell you what I want to tell you. He doesn't tell Jeremiah what he's going to tell him. Doesn't explain anything. Jeremiah, in obedience, without any question, gets up and he walks to where God has told him. So he goes and he watches the potter put this piece of budget clay on the wheel, the potter's wheel. I don't know if any of you know the process of kneading the clay, preparing it for a pot. They basically get the material from whomever is making it, or they make it themselves. They have what's called a pug mill, which draws the air out of the clay And then he takes the wedge, and they take it, and they're throwing it on the wall, on the table, trying to shape it into a ball, like this. So they're just beating it up, trying to get the extra air out that they themselves didn't get out, okay? Then the potter takes the clay after he beat it up on the table, and he puts it through a press. It's like these two wheels and a crank. And he puts the clay through these wheels, and he cranks it. And he puts it through the press to get what other impurities there might be. And there might be some rocks, might be some stone, might be whatever, some more air pockets. Puts it through the press. And then after it goes through the press, he starts to cut away from it and form different pieces. Sometimes they take the pieces, they put them in an already formed shape to make it a particular shape, or they keep them in little wedges so that they can put them on top of the spinner wheel. Now I'm gonna say thingamabob spinner wheel, and whatchamacallit, while I'm talking about this process, so y'all just kind of bear with me here. So now steps 1 through 3, these are the trials and the tribulations that we go through. God is the potter. God has to take the wind from us, because sometimes, as I learned with my son, sometimes we speak out of turn. And so you have to punch him in the middle of his chest to take his wind. So he knows, I'm going to need you to slow it down a little bit and hear what I'm saying. Okay? Your trials and your tribulations, you go through the press. You have to get those impurities out of you. You have to press the olive and the oil. You got to keep pressing it down and keep pressing it down and keep pressing it down to get every little piece out of you that is supposed to be there. Then God's going to start cutting stuff away. He's going to prune you down when you think that you've got this big, beautiful bush. And it's time, your season is over. So he says, now I got to prune you back so that you be ready for the next season. These are the trials and tribulations we go through for the perfection of, for the purpose of God. Okay? So then the next step is the wedges for the pots are centered on the wheel. The centering of the clay is the most important and critical step of creating the pot. Because if it's off center, it won't be able to move the way the potter is trying to get it to go. So, because this is the foundation of it. So this is the pot. A pot is only as strong as the centering. So you take this thing and you put it on the center. It has to be in the right place for God to work it. You with your own agenda over here, it ain't gonna work. Because he's not gonna know how to center you in that position, because that's not where the purpose is. The purpose is back here. This is where the purpose is. So again, that's a key position. So this is the intimate relationship with God. This is your prayer life. This is your obedience. These are all the things that make you and God one. It has to be solid. You can't call yourself casting out a demon or ill-begotten spirit from somebody if you have no prayer life. It's gonna look at you like it did the disciples and say, we don't know you, and we don't know you, but Jesus, we know you. The devil's gonna tear your tail up every time you call yourself casting something out of somebody, and God forbid it latch on to you. And unfortunately, we have folks that do that. These are the false prophets. So, your intimacy with God has got to be there. You cannot just open your Bible on Sunday. Can't do it. I'm trying to be good, y'all. So, okay, so, the next step, once you have centered the clay properly on the wheel, is now the potter will take his fist, or like this, and he puts his hand as he's adding the water smack dab in the middle of it to start to form the opening of the pot. And then what he does, is he takes his hands and he never lets the pot go. And his hands always stay on the pot. Then he takes his thumbs and he puts them on the inside because he still has to be connected to the inside part of you, inside of the pot. And he, as it's moving around, now keep in mind there's many dynamics going on. You got your wheel spinning, you got the man's foot going back and forth, you got the hands in there, and what happens is he takes the clay, again, he never takes his hands away, and he slowly, either wants, if he wants a vase, he will slowly bring it up, and it will eventually, if he has centered it correctly, and the contact or the centerpiece is correct, it will rise the way it's supposed to rise. It'll form the pot the way it's supposed to form. The lip will be just right. It won't have the impurities or anything in it. Then it's ready for the kiln. Now you go back into the fire to burn off the rest of it once it has hardened. Okay? Now, what happens is, these are the moments that God is trying to elevate us. But because of our stubborn ways, our disobedience, he ain't talking to me. And that's somebody else's job, right? Nobody me? Okay. We, the clay, which is us, cause the potter to start this process all over again. We wonder why you keep starting over in the same kind of craziness. For years, I would wonder why, didn't I just do this? Didn't I just read this right here? Didn't I just read this? And God said, mm-hmm, but you got to the green step, and you decided to go your own way, thinking I was going to finish your work. I'm not here to finish your work, you're here to finish mine. So because you didn't finish that step, and we sure didn't even touch that one, we only go back up here, so to make sure that you really did get the process right. So you start back up here at the very top. You don't start over from the step that you messed up. You start back from the beginning. So if you ever wonder why you keep repeating the same old mistakes, it's because you're not learning the lesson in the mistakes. That's the whole purpose of making mistakes. God knew we were going to make mistakes. That's why Jesus Christ died for us. Okay? So if don't nobody know that, I'm here to tell you. That's why Jesus died for us. Because of the mistakes he knew we were going to make. But if you don't understand the lesson and the mistake, how do you testify of the glory of Jesus? How do you testify? That's what a testimony is. It's not that you just got through where you think it was finished. Because God is going to say, yeah, it's a okay pot. But it can't hold all that I need to be put into it. So I'm going to have to break it again. And he does. He breaks it down. He breaks it. He puts it back into a dust. And then he adds the water again. He said, let's go on, surface over again.
There you go.
And he does the form all over again. You do the wedge, you beat the wedge up, you go back to the press, you go back to the centering, you go back to the pulling up and the elevation. And each elevation that you have, there's a new process.
Amen.
It's the same process, but it's a different way. So, ask yourself, what is the wood chip in my shoe preventing me from being centered in God? Do you have to be made over and over and over? Do you? For real. Keep in mind that God knows that we're going to make these mistakes. But there's a point that God said, enough is enough. He's going to take it out of your hands. And then he's going to come in like a mighty storm. He's going to shake your shoulder to see if you will listen one more time. God's mercy. mercy and his grace is going to come in the house one more time. And he's going to shake you from the very foundation that he created you. But he wants to understand it. You're going to say, and we have all said it this way, it doesn't matter if we are doomed or not. God is a forgiving God. Oh, he'll forgive me again. He'll forgive me again. Or we say, let the chips fall where they may. We can't be possibly serious, for real. We can't be serious with that mindset. What's it going to take for us to heed the warnings that God has been given? Every place, every person that's within the sound of my voice, and then some, has got warning after warning after warning. There's been a mass, chaotic shift in the atmosphere. And if you have not experienced it yet, just hold on, because it's come. God wants to see who's going to really serve him. You cannot serve two masters.
Amen.
You cannot straddle the fence. And he is saying enough is enough. And until you say enough is enough, you won't be the pot that gets broken again. I don't know if any of you have ever had, and I know some of you, because we've talked about it, have ever experienced a soul-shaking beating by God. It is one that literally makes the hair on the back of your neck stand. It is something that is within your gut that this cry that you have, you can't even get the sound out. It's something within that God says, like they did back in the day when your grandma used to take you and dip you in the water or get you when you came out the tub, because that was the best beating that you ever had.
Ooh.
Bare butt naked. God is going to shake some sugar up in here.
All right.
And I'm here to tell you, this message, I'm like Jeremiah. I don't want to tell them these things. I don't want to tell them these things because they're going to think it's me talking. It's not me talking, y'all. I'm telling you, there is a shift that is coming up in this house that if you don't get it right, if you don't, and I'm not saying people out there being this crazy, chaotic thing like what's going on in Ferguson, people just blatantly going out there. It's the small things. They said it's the fox at the bottom of the vine that destroys the root. It's those small things that we keep missing. That's why we keep repeating the mistakes. So I'm telling you, I'm giving you this warning. Hear me well. Hear me well. It's time to change. Change. There's nothing wrong with giving up the things that you've outgrown. We know that women with our clothes, and men should know that too. When they're too small, it's time to give them away.
Amen.
Now, I'm guilty of saying, I might get to lose that 10 pounds right there and get back into that little skirt. I just need to give it away. I just need to give it away. That'd be half my clothes, but you know what I'm saying, right? And those men, I mean, I know y'all have these favorite pants who seem in between the gong, or you have these t-shirts that stick over your belly like right here. And you're like, no, this is my favorite t-shirt. It's time. Give it to your wife. Give it. It's time to get rid of the things that we have outgrown. So let's talk about the next part of the chapter. Jeremiah hears that the priests have plotted against him. They want him dead because for whatever reason they believe that killing him is going to stop the prophecy of certain doom. How stupid can you be? There's a difference between being stupid because you know better and ignorant because you don't have the knowledge. That is pure D stupid. And they will be able to return to the life of, it really doesn't matter, y'all. I can deal with the consequences of my actions. I've heard that so many times. I've heard that. So, my own son, I'm going to use my son as a guinea pig today, told me that he could deal with the consequences of his actions. He got himself in a position that I said, okay, you're going to push me too far. You're going to push me too far, and you're not going to like the consequences. I can handle it. I can deal with it. We have all told our children that one way or the other. And we've been told by our parents or whoever has been around us the same thing. And when it came down to the consequences, these are your comments. Oh my God, I don't belong with them. Them are kind of folks. Oh my God, that's not me. That's not me. Or, I thought I could handle it, but can you give me a little help? And God is telling you, I will not deny you this process, nor will I deny you this pain, because it is necessary for my purpose. So I'm here to tell you, those with that mindset, that you can deal with the consequences that come your way, y'all still in chain of pants. We all still in chain of pants if that's our mindset. You know, the big draws, the ones who are the big draws, those are the folks that say, I think I'm going to stop now. I think I'm going to stop. I'm going to heed your warning, Lord. I'm going to stop. I'll deal with what I've done to this point. The priests want to not only kill him eventually, but they also want to first destroy his credibility. People don't just come up and kill you anymore. Like, they don't just fight head up anymore. They first got to destroy your character and your credibility. If they ain't nothing but all hoo-hoo out there. So, ask yourself this question, and you can silently give yourself the answer. How many times have you tried to help somebody, in the midst of you helping, they didn't like what you said? So now, this big assassination plot going on about your character. It is believed to destroy the legacy of your character is to kill the God you serve. Destroy the legacy, that which you're trying to build. Because a child is not only your legacy, it is your action, it is your work. Destroy the root of the seed of the servant who proclaims the word of God. Hear what I'm saying. There's two things that a person should never be able to take away from you. Is your name and your word. These should always be top priority. There are different dynamics that go along with all that, but these are two things I'm talking about, your word and your name. They should never be able to take those things from you. But what happens is, they will go and say, and I'm saying they, as a generalization, they will do a slow little, so what you think of the Pookie? Yeah, you saw what Pookie did the other day, right? Yeah. I don't know if I would have did it like that, but you know. Yeah, you saw what Ray Ray and Shanina was doing? Yeah, okay. And then so now you planted a seed in somebody else's head, like, they're looking at Ray Ray, Pookie, and Shanina in a totally different light now the next time they see them. Thoughts that never weren't there until you planted them. Yes. So, what you have to do is, so then what happens is, the seed then goes a little further, and it goes a little further, and it goes a little further to the point where they're like, your name is doo-doo when mentioned. I can go back home right now, and because of my name, what my father has built my name, our name to be, Amory, I can go into places that other people can't. We all have some part of our family because of the legacies that have been left behind. And that's a good thing. But it's when you say, you might go into a school and you're there for a parent-teacher conference and someone's coming and they say, can I help you? And you say, yeah, I'm here for Buddy's conference. They go, oh, your Buddy's mom. And your mind says, what did Buddy do all day long? That he is the choice talk of people. So you have to be very careful of what people will do with your name and your word. And crying Peter Wolf just because you want attention will destroy your word. Y'all understand the story about Peter Wolf? Peter cried wolf too many times. He always says something was wrong. Here come the wolf, here come the wolf. And here come the henchmen, you know, and they come in, they try to kill it, and he's not there. Well, when the wolf finally came, when that incident finally came, he got ate up because he cried wolf too many times. Peter Wolf.
Amen.
Protect your name. Protect your word. People don't have any mercy. They tear you limb from limb in the name of love. Then, when you're dead, when they killed you by what they made you go through, they say you didn't have any character. They weep big, bitter tears, but not for you, but for themselves, because now they've lost their toy. So what I'm saying is, what better way to attempt to destroy God than to destroy the credibility of the messenger of God?
Amen.
Because sometimes we are the only Jesus somebody may see. They may never step their foot into a building, a big church, a small church. They may not even come to your home for Bible study, whatever you do. If your display, your actions, don't speak that you're a messenger of God, a minister of God, you destroy it. I'm not going to give any accolades to that new little program that's on TV. I'm not going to mention his name. I have my own opinions about that. I'm all for comedy because we do need to laugh. But what are we laughing at? What are we laughing at? We're laughing at a bunch of mess. And we say, take it in stride. It's all right. So the last part of the story talks about heeding the warning. After these people have attempted to kill his character and kill him personally, because they've already dug the hole for him to be in, he says to himself, he says to God, you know what? Okay, God, I don't have enough. Go on, do what you're going to do. Because, see, they didn't hear a thing he said. They didn't hear a thing I said. That even when I interceded on behalf of you, they didn't even hear me. They still want to kill me. So, as I come to my close, if I could get the ministerial team this way. We have to get ourselves in the right position for change.